We've got a problem today. We'll bring some chairs in. Just scoot over to make sure everybody has a seat. We had 230 people here first service, which was great. And for those of you that appreciate my dress, I want to thank those who came and were part of cleaning the sidewalks this morning. If you'll notice, the two elders have their ties and suits on. Some of us were here working. They were obviously at home in front of the mirror getting their lipstick on. Another thing, and I make this personal, but several people have asked me, why did you shave when it got down to near zero? If you trim one and mess up, you have to start over. And that's what happened last night. To really boost your ego, I was around my wife for about 3 hours after I'd shaved. This morning we got up, obviously I'd shaved. My friend said, Jill, just look at me. And she stood there and looked at me and went, what? So anyway, if she's in here, I shaved. Okay. Let me take a minute to say something very, very, very important. I need everybody's attention. When I get up on Sunday mornings to preach, and I think this is okay to say this morning, this area will be pretty full, this area will be pretty full, and this area will be pretty full, and this area there's an island, and I think y'all know what I'm talking about, where not a lot of people sit. And there's been a real ministry to a particular individual who will talk out loud and sometimes inappropriate and that type of thing. Is everything okay? Right? Okay. We found out we're dealing with front lobal dementia, and that is a real ministry for the church. And we love this person, and we're going to do everything we can to take care of them. But it took a long time to find family and connect what was totally going on. And today I'm able to say something because of an absence. Now, normally you wouldn't do that in church, but I think I'm on a court. Lori just got back from China, but Lori's already said they'll be part of the ministry to be there. And I know my wife has agreed to, and Tammy and some others, to make sure and help this person. So if there's something inappropriate said, even some cursing at times, it's part of the disease. Okay, but it's called a front lobal dementia. That tends to hit people that it does hit in 40s or 50s. So God be praised. God be praised that he's called us to be a part of that. It's hard to even talk about, okay? It's good to see everybody this morning. Fantastic. Thanks for getting out. I do want to take a minute to thank all of those, especially Freddie Jones and Joseph Redmond. I don't know who else they had here with them yesterday, cleared the parking lot. John Payne met me early this morning, and a couple other guys jumped in, Andrew Smith and some others, and got the sidewalks ready and softed, and I really appreciate them doing that and made it able to where we could come worship this morning without anybody falling. I don't know if you've noticed, but it's cold. Couple of announcements. I see Will Little's back there, so he needs to hear this announcement. Where are you, Will? February the 7th, this is for all 20 and 30-year-old men. February the 7th, we're going to meet here at the church, and I want to do a Bible study with you that night. We'll talk more about it as time goes, but get it on your calendar, February the 7th. It's a Tuesday night, and Will that work? I hope now that I've announced it, okay. Will's going to be able to come and speak to the guys just a little bit, and it's just going to be a good time. Will is a Major League Baseball umpire, and he's in now before they do their spring thing. So look forward to that on February the 7th, 20 and 30-year-old men. Also, toward the end of the month, and I think it's January 27th, is that what we said? It's a Friday night, January 27th and 28th. Elders and deacons, and we'll get all this out. It's all confirmed yesterday. We will have our annual retreat, but we're going to do it local at the Wellness Center in Elizabethan. It's behind the hospital. When you go to the Wellness Center, the right side is where all the exercise takes place. The left side is a meeting room where eating takes place. Mark Norman and I met. We're going to the left side, okay? But it'll be Friday evening. We'll come home, sleep in our own beds, everything. Won't involve a lot of travel. And then Saturday morning for a couple of hours. So look forward to that. Elders and deacons, get it on your calendar. and your elder will be in touch with you deacons. So keep that in mind. And I'll go ahead and announce this now. Several had asked if there'll ever be another one of those gun classes if you're visiting. Again, I go through, that's an odd announcement, we're not going crazy, we're just having fun target shooting. But there will be one, it's a concealed carry class, there will be one, I think it's the 30th and 31st, but it's that Monday and Tuesday, 27th, 28th, 9th. 30th and 31st, Monday night and Tuesday night at Shooter's Edge over in Piney Flats. So if anybody wants to do that, I need to know. I need to know because they'll limit the size of classes. So I need to know if you want to do that. Now, let's do some church things that are important. Going to start a series on Moses. You'll hear more about that as we go, but it'll be the whole idea of God's provision with this man from his birth all the way through, how God uses people like you and me. And we're going to start that today. And also today we're going to be singing How Great Thou Art, but there is a wonderful song being introduced after that titled
No Longer Slaves.
No Longer Slaves, and that'll go perfectly with Moses and what we're doing is why we're using it. So I want to thank Eric and the crew. They got in here bright and early this morning when it was a balmy 7 or 8 degrees, and we're going to have some wonderful music today. So is everybody ready to worship?
Yes.
You ready for me to be quiet?
Yes.
Okay, let's pray together and worship. God, we give you praise for this time, for all that's going on in the church, Father. Be with us. Allow us today, Father, to grow closer to you by becoming more like Christ. And Father, our prayer is simple, that you hear our words of praise today as coming from our hearts, our minds, our very beings, Father, in adoration for who you are. Father, we sing, we praise, and we love you. The simple song, How Great Thou Art. Let's stand together. Amen. Have worship.
I hear the roar.
David said, this next song that we're going to be singing together is a song called No Longer Slaves. And I love this song and just the simple message that it says that I am no longer a slave to fear, but I am a child of God. One of the things that I think connects all people, whether you're a Christ follower, whether you're not, from whatever perspective you come from, whatever you believe, whether you're hurt, damaged, all the things that connect us together is our brokenness. We're all broken. The difficulty just of living, I think we all are aware of. The beautiful thing about being in Christ, about being a follower of Christ, is that we have hope. We trust in Jesus and that He has taken our fears, our the weight, just every wound that we have, and has made it new. He's used it for His glory. He's healed. He's restored. He's made us truly alive, and that's a beautiful thing. It's just amazing.
Amen.
Amen. So this song is a song that just simply declares that over our lives, over our church, over the world, that Jesus is who He says He is, and that we are His children, that He's invited us into His family, that He's called us His own. And a God who is almighty, who is worthy of all His praise, looks at us in love. As someone who follows Christ, that is something that doesn't make sense. It's a beautiful thing. So this song, like I said, is a song that we don't know, so feel free to sing along with us. We'll teach it to you, but just if you don't feel comfortable, just listen to the words that speak to you. Yes, let's sing this song to you.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
That's a song. Let's sing that together.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Sin, you unravel me.
As you unravel me with a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave. This womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again to a family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Sons and daughters, you have made us a part of your family. God, that you can take our brokenness and our shame, every guilt, every hurt, from abuse to addiction, everything, God, you take it away. You heal us. You use it for your good. It's wow. That's awesome. Thank you, God, for who you are, for Jesus, and showing us just in the true fullness who you are. Lord, help us to believe words like that. And help us to carry that to other people, to show that healing to others in every way. God, help us to trust you fully. God, be with us as we continue to worship in this time. As we take communion, we remember your death, we remember your sacrifice. Lord, we love you, and we thank you so much for who you are, for what you have done for each and every one of us. It's in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, our friend, our healer, everything. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Go ahead and grab a seat.
God provides. He always has. And as David said to us earlier, over the next several weeks, he's going to be preaching a sermon series about Moses. And it's through these sermons where we will see our God providing for his people. The mere existence of Moses is evidence enough of God's providence. At the time of Moses' birth, Pharaoh had ordered every Hebrew boy who was born to be thrown into the Nile River. But Moses' mother hid him. And she hid him as long as she felt like she could. But when she felt like she could hide him away no longer, she placed her faith in God, and she placed her son in a basket. And she floated that basket with her son down the river. That's where Moses was found by Pharaoh's daughter. And she raised him as her own. And Moses' new mother made sure that he was cared for and that he would grow to a man, to become a man. Once again, God provided. Years later, God saw the misery that was within the Israelite people. So he used Moses to help free them from their oppression. And even though Moses offered up one excuse after another to get out of his call, God enabled and equipped Moses with everything he needed to fulfill the will of God. And the people of Israel would become freed from their captivity. Once again, God provides. But in their escape, the Israelites and Moses made it all the way to the Red Sea. But they ran into a barrier. The Egyptian army was behind them. The Red Sea was before them, and they were unable to cross. And it appeared as though they had made it this far, just to be executed at the hands of the Egyptians. That is, until they called upon the name of God. He not only parted the Red Sea to open a path for them to freedom, but he also released the waters at just the right time to completely destroy the Egyptian army. And once again, God provides. But then the Israelites, they found another enemy. This time it was themselves. They become disenchanted with their newfound freedom, and they complained constantly about everything. But God gave them everything that they needed. When they needed food, he dropped down manna and quail from heaven. When they needed water, God provided water from a rock. Two pretty incredible miracles. Once again, God provides. And when the Israel nation needed God's law to guide them and to protect them, and according to Isaiah 42:6, so that they could become a light to the nations and to open the eyes of the blind, God gave Moses the words that caused him to chisel out two stones. He told Moses to take those stones to the top of Mount Sinai, and upon those stones, God wrote the law. Once again, God provided. Each of these events I've described were times when God saved his people from certain death, whether it's the death as an infant, as a slave, as a refugee, or as a wandering people. Imminent death was defeated by the hand of God. In many ways, we're just like these Israelites. We concern ourselves with physical death, and we call upon God to save us from it. But we know that we have an even greater concern, the spiritual death. From that, we are completely unable to deliver ourselves. We are helpless without a Savior. And the good news is, we have one. God has provided. Our enemies, sin and death, have been defeated. We have been saved not just once, but for all time. God has given us this Savior, Jesus Christ. God's victory, our victory, is the reason that we meet this morning and every Lord's Day at his table. We remember that Jesus himself gave his body, and his blood is a living sacrifice. We remember that God gave his only begotten Son that we might have eternal life. God has indeed provided. He always has, and he always will provide that we might be called children of God.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have provided a way for us to come to you through your Son, Jesus, that in him we can come to you in prayer and look forward to the day when we can be with you forever, and he also. We come around this table to remember your Son, Christ Jesus. We take his body and his blood. Father, we ask you to help us to remember what these stand for. Lord, we come seeking your forgiveness, and we ask you to use us in ways that would be for your glory. We ask you to bless this loaf, which is his body, and this blood, the cup that we take, that you would lead us to be with him. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As children of God, we get to share together in the body and the blood of our Savior.
Pray with me, please. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity we have to gather in your house this morning. We thank you for the warmth and the spirit in this place that you have provided so that we might come and worship you. We thank you for the blessings of life that you've shared with us, and at this time that we will have an opportunity to share back with you. We just ask that you go with us and that you keep us, that you got our hearts and our feet so that we might serve you. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning, I've had mic problems all day. This morning, where Mark Norman?
Yes.
Take over the offering plate for him. I want to say something about Mark. Come on up here, Mark. This morning, when I saw Mark, it just, I think in bizarre ways, but I saw the sweater and turned around, and I thought of a human chess set. And that's got to be the king, right? As tall as he is, but back up a little, Mark, because if you're a king on a human chessboard, who would stand in front of you?
A pawn.
A pawn. So, John, come up here this morning. And I want you to stand there and look like a pawn. Now, if you're going to play chess, what have you got to have?
Another team.
Another team. Easy question. Paul Buck, come up here. Where are you? Come up here, Paul. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the human chess set. Two pawns and a king. Thank you guys for being here. Yeah, you're special. Now, Paul knew I was going to do that. He's been practicing. Show him what you were doing. Yeah, okay. and to God be all glory. We're on live. We were first service. How many? 400?
400.
400 people were tuned in while we were doing first service live, and we're doing second. Don't make that a habit, by the way. But those of you that are watching live, thanks for being here. And I'm going to ask you on the site, if you're watching live, just type a comment with your name. So whenever you were here with us this morning, I'm going to read some from the first service. Good friend of mine, one of the closest friends in the world, a guy named Harry Huff, lives in Florida, says, nice suit, preacher, LOL. Tony and Sharon Barger, Sharon said, Tony and Sharon Barger are watching live and trying to make it to the second service if we can hobble out our driveway. And they were able to hobble out their driveway. And Sharon's been under some major surgeries, legs, recently, and she's here this morning in the ice. So thank you, Sharon. Nancy Kinchlow, we are watching live at BCCC. James Kelly Sr., do you know your dad, Sharon? He's in Florida also and says, is that a new Tennessee suit David is wearing? Allison Elliott, watching from home. Thanks for this technology. Slick here. Be safe, everyone. And a lot of us love the music. Lisa Minervini, who moved to North Carolina. I so miss my church family. Shirley Wilkes watching live, love my church. Rachel Baker, August and I are watching while eating peanut butter toast. So I will tell you, when the weather's nice next week, come on back. And everybody, if you want to bring peanut butter toast and eat it here, that will be fine too. I want to talk a little bit about Moses this morning to introduce Moses. And I'm going to share with you what one of the elders said. You ever had somebody tell you a joke and you know what they're really trying to say to you? And one of my elders came up today and said to me before the first service, I mean, if you notice, crowd's down a little, right? And one of the elders came up and said, did you hear about the revival in the Midwest where the preacher came and they promoted revival and the weather was bad and one guy came, a rancher came. He's the only one showed up at church. And that preacher got up and preached 45 minutes, just really, really poured it on. And the rancher came up to him later and said, you know, I really enjoyed that sermon. He said, well, thank you. He said, let me tell you one other thing. When I'm feeding my cattle, if only one shows up at the barn, I don't unload the whole truck. Now, I realized what he was trying to tell me this morning, but then he had a goofy sweater on, so what can I say? Five stages. I want to give you five stages that a lady, Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross recognized when people are dying. She knows when they were sick and dying. And these five stages begin to be tested and found in most people through the stages of dying. And then the application started being made and very useful in counseling of people go through this during any trauma in their life, loss of a job, the death of someone else, a marriage collapse, whatever it could be. That when people were dealing with trauma, they tended to go through these five stages, sometimes just for moments, sometimes get stuck in them and it's a problem. But the five stages were, first of all, denial, and then there's anger, then there's bargaining, and then maybe some depression associated with it, and then acceptance, that they learn to live and find good life again. And I was thinking about that and getting this sermon series ready and what I want to say today. And I thought about one incident specific in my life where I was working as a chaplain for the police department and a young man had been killed. It was a murder. And I had been at the scene of what had happened and then I went with a uniformed officer and the ID and the badge and all to knock on the door at 2 a.m. to carry that news to a mother. I'd never met her. It's some of the worst news you can ever deliver. And we had a process we go through, but you do not, you show up someone's door at 2 a.m. to knock on it. You're not there for small talk, obviously. So you get right to what happened. I'm sorry to inform you that your son has been killed. And then you start talking with the person. We'd stay with them until a family member or a friend came. And I knocked on the lady's door, and she came to the door and said, what do you want, what do you want? You could see, very traumatized. She knew it wasn't good. And I took her by the arms, walked in, and told her. And she looked at me and said, you're kidding me, aren't you? Denial. huge example of denial. You're kidding me. Like you would show up at 2 in the morning, someone you didn't know, to say that. I want you to know, and think of those stages, not in particular, that our lives go through stages. We're going to look at a Psalm of Moses, Psalm 90, before we go into Exodus and all the stories. And I want you to see three stages. It's called the Psalm of Moses. And I'm going to ask everybody here, I'm not going to put it up on the screen today, I'm going to ask everybody here to turn to Psalm 90. While you're doing that, hear this, Psalm 90. While you're doing that, hear this. My brother, he's here today. I'm going to tell you something happened. We had, in my mind, one of the best Christmases I've ever been a part of with our children here. I had a ball with them here. And my brother one day, and my wife Jill, and my sister-in-law, Gay, and the little kids, they all went to Dollywood. And when they got there with the passes and tickets and everything they had one extra ticket. And there was two ladies going in. My brother's telling me about this. Two ladies going in, and he saw there was a lady with her mother, and there was a long line. It was very crowded after Christmas, and there was a long line of people buying tickets, and he realized what was going on. He said, "Do you need a ticket?" And they said, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, I've got a ticket, and I'll just give it to you, and you won't have to stand in line." They had one ticket and needed one. He said, "You won't have to stand in line." And the lady said, "Oh, this is from Jesus. This is from Jesus." And it's a great story. It's a good story. And I don't mean to rain, or I guess today, snow on parades. But I want you to think about a second what was being said from a theological point of view. The God of all creation, spoke everything into being. He decides that man is so broken, which is Eric shared today, we all have that in common, that we're so broken that he is going to imprison himself in time and space, skin and dates, for 33 years. Miserable existence for God. He's going to be spit on by those he created. They're going to plan to kill him before they're even able to do it, by those he created and loved so much. And they nail him to a tree, to boards. A torturous and humiliating way to die because of who it was reserved for. And then there was resurrection and all the glory of the resurrection, a new body was given to him. I don't think it's so someone could get into Dollywood. I think it's much more important than that. And that lady believes that too. I'm 100% sure. It's just a phrase we've used to adopt. But we need Jesus, because without him, we're going to hell. Okay? And we don't talk about that enough. We need Jesus because without him, we stay broken through all eternity. We need Jesus because every one of us had 5 less seconds to live on this earth than we had 5 seconds ago. You don't get the time back. We went to, and that's why I like to pack everything you can into every day. That's about life being good and enjoy. Now, does that mean fret around all the time? No, but life should be enjoy. I getting ready to preach a sermon and think about it. We went four-wheeling yesterday with Tammy and John Payne and Mike and Karen Lewis. Mike's fun to go four-wheeling with. He's got this big four-wheel drive, four-door truck that had 700 miles on it, so he didn't want to get off the road and in the snow. No, I'm kidding. And then Tammy and John, we went up a hill where we're getting stuck. You need to go to her Facebook and see that, because she was videoing it, and just hear what's being said in their truck. But anyway, if you could tie a string to Tammy's molars and hook them to a tree, it'd pull the truck up. And, you know, so bottom line, we went out and had a lot of fun. Taking way too much time to tell you about. And we had a ball, off-road, four-wheeling in the snow. And I must say this part, though, Mike. John Payne said he brought a chain with his Ford in case Mike's Honda got stuck. And I'll just add, I brought a Jeep in case they both got stuck. But we went, we had fun, we were eating dinner last night. I don't even remember what was being talked about. And Mike in laughter was talking about something. He said, that's 18 hours of my life that I'll never get back. Our lives are full of those times. And you're going to learn a lot from this psalm about Moses that'll help us, I hope, start looking at the events of his life, as Mark said at the table today, that it's about God providing. It's not just little stories. Moses was a person just like you and I, just like every one of us. Now, go to Psalm 90, and you're going to see three stages. I mentioned Elizabeth Kubler-Ross identified stages. I just want you to be thinking of stages is why I do that. The first stage most of us go through in life is this stage of we can do it. We absolutely can do anything. You hear about teenagers lots of times that they just feel like they're invincible, and if somebody gets hurt or killed in a car wreck, that's because they're not as good a driver as I am, and I'm just invincible. That's a stage we tend to go through. We are so overconfident that we're dangerous for ourselves and others. We know everything there is to know about life. Every one of us tend to go through that stage. Think of Moses. We read these miraculous stories of how he was saved when all the other children were dying, a lot like Christ, and that he was floating in this basket, but then it's like the richest person in the world, the most powerful person in the world finds him, and this lady has this love for him, this maternal instinct says, we'll raise him as our own, and takes him into Pharaoh's palace with the most powerful person on earth. He's raised in all the splendor and education, everything the world had to offer. He could do anything. We raise our kids saying you can be anything you want to be. When that's a lie, you can't. If I want to be a jet fighter, I can't flap my arms and fly. You know, you can't be anything you want to be. But we raise our kids telling them you can be anything you want to be. I will promise you, I would like to be, I want to be an NFL running back. I want to play for the Dallas Cowboys. It ain't going to happen. But we believe it can. And here's Moses, so overconfident. And bring it back to our spiritual lives. How often do we think, I don't even really need God. I'll check in with him every now and then and tell him what he needs to do. You listen to how we pray sometimes, telling God what he needs to do. I mean, seriously, listen to prayer. God heal this person. God do this. God, telling him what he needs to do. And when you come in contact with God, that tends to get knocked down. Psalms 91 through 5, the Psalm of Moses. It's about him. Okay? And listen what it says. Lord, and hear this as being real confident yourself. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Verse 2, real emphasis. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world from everlasting to everlasting. What's it say? You are God. Now, when you're overconfident and think you can accomplish everything, if you read that, you begin to think, wait, I won't be here that long. God was here before the mountains. I wasn't. God was here before there was even a measurement of time or a mountain anywhere in existence. I wasn't. You know? You're the one that's God. And then it says you turn people back to dust, saying, remember, or return to dust, you mortals. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that's just gone by. We misquote that sometimes in its application. But just telling us how big God is, how little we are. Or like a watch in the night, that would be a shift, one shift of work, you know, 1,000 days or years, or just like that one shift to you. And yet you sweep people away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass of the morning. In the morning it springs up new, but by evening it is dry and withered. When I get real arrogant, when I start thinking, look what I've done, when I start thinking, wow, this is amazing, I can do so much. We've got to come back and say, we're nothing without God. And wouldn't it be better if we started teaching our children, you're nothing without God.
And then think what we're telling them, because God can do things. Okay? To give them the confidence that comes from God. But give ourselves that confidence that comes from God, not from who we are. Because what happens next is that second stage of life. If you think you can do it all of a sudden it hits you that you're not making it. You're not getting it done. You're not, your business isn't the business you thought it was going to be. And you start recognizing I failed. And that tends to become the second stage of most people's lives, the second stage of Moses. See, Moses had everything going his way, and then he messed up, didn't he? And he had to go live not only away from the palace, but he had to go live as a nobody, basically tending sheep in a wilderness. He was nobody. He had failed. And what happened so easy, and I see this a lot if we were to equate it to ages, it tends to be the pendulum of overconfidence to the pendulum of we're tied to our failures. Our identity becomes everything that went wrong. You know, we're mad at everybody in the world because we had a bad daddy. We're mad at everybody in the world because a job we got in didn't work out the way we thought it would, or the degree I got, I didn't find work in it. And that becomes our identity. Every failure we've ever had, and we start running around addicted and chained, and hear this, to basically fear. Why try? It never works out for me anyway. And we become bitter toward other people. We become jealous toward other people. And we become bitter with God. We may never say it, but we just start thinking, God, if only you would have. And so we're mad at him. I read a resume one time a young man had sent to a church. And he was working part-time with us in Florida. And he made application to a church and used me as a reference. And when they read the resume, they called me. I felt sorry because they called almost laughing. And they said, "We want to ask you about this guy, but we want to ask you about something he said in his resume." I said, "Okay." They said, "He put in his resume because we asked, would you include a vision you have for our church?" And their church was a rural, small church that had gone through some problems, and they were letting somebody come in and help them heal and help them start growing again. And he wrote about this little church. He said, "My vision for the church is that it will become the largest church in the world, with other churches from around the world coming to us to seek counsel." That's not a lofty goal, is it? I want Boone's Creek to be the largest church in the world. Now, here we got a little competition in Korea where there's one of about 50 or 75,000. But we'll get there eventually. They've only got a few thousand people for every one we have. But we'll get there eventually. If you all will just get busy, bring them. But you see how that works in every job there is in the world? Then all of a sudden you start saying, why didn't it happen? I was so overconfident, and now there's failure on top of failure, and that's why try? Why even try? And I think a lot of us find ourselves stuck in that situation. Why try? Bitter toward God. I want to read you something, a quote I wrote down. If you have worked to know God for a decade or more, if you got that? If you have worked to know God for a decade or more, you are almost certain to cross into a spiritual wasteland. And during that time, you'll ask, why even try? Why even try? And you'll start counting successes in God's story in one hand. And it's real easy to become bitter and broken and angry at everybody and say, they got my way, God. Or why didn't you help me, God? You know, if you're a Christian, now listen to, if you're a human, but if you're a Christian, you're going to face cruelty from other people in your life. You're going to run up against anger somewhere, sometime. You are going to be the victim of a lot of people's complaining in your life.
You will face pressures that seem unreal to you. And you will face times when people are judging you. Now, maybe if you're stuck in that first stage, you think, that won't happen to me. Everybody's going to like me. I remember my first ministry. Some people got upset with me as a youth ministry. I felt like, why even try? I'm going to quit. I'm sorry. I'm worthless. But they're in my way. And I had an uncle that asked me, he said, have you made anybody mad at the church yet? And I said, yeah. And he said, great, you're doing a good job. And literally at that time, it saved my ministry. So listen to that again, because I think we're shocked by it if we're trying to hold on to that I'm invincible. But listen to it. If you are a Christian, you're going to face some cruelty. You're living it out. You're going to face some evil in your life. Maybe your own evil, your own failures. You're going to be angry or have people angry with you. There's going to be times when you hear a lot of complaints. You're going to feel pressures that you don't even feel free to let people know are going on around you. And you'll be judged and you'll wonder. You'll just flat wonder. And you can fill in any way you want to that. I'm wondering. But you'll face it. And what can happen so often there is we get stuck in self-pity and feel cheated even by God. Now I want you to hear me, church, real close. A lot of people in church today are stuck with the identity of self-pity. A lot of people are stuck in the identity of self-pity. Why did this happen to me? Why didn't the world see everything the way I see the world? And we feel broken. And a lot of people live out a tremendous number of their days doing nothing but feeling sorry for themselves and bitter. The psalm addressed that. And the psalm addressed it in a way we maybe don't like by saying, when you see everything around you broken, look in the mirror and see how broken you are. All of those things that go wrong in our life are because of sin. And we're one of the sinners. We're one of the sinners. It's hard for us to believe. We can pray sometimes. If there's anybody here today that needs to know the Lord, I pray they'll hear. We all need to know the Lord. And I don't care where we are in our faith walk, we need to know Him a little better. Okay? And listen to what's said in this same psalm. When this self-confidence is busted by saying, God's a little bit bigger than you. He's the one in charge. Then he flips it right back and says, if you're getting angry, a little bit of self-pity, listen. Verse 7. We are consumed by your anger and terrified by your indignation. Talking about God. You have set our iniquities before you. My iniquities, okay, are before God. My secret sins are on in the light of your presence, God. And all of our days pass away under your wrath. We finish our years with a moan. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 years. Our strength may endure, I'll say, longer. Yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrows, for they quickly pass and will fly away. Read that. Get down real close. And look what it says. The best of them, of your days, are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass. They quickly pass. I'm going to tell you something, and I don't think it's weird. I just think I'm articulating where most of us are. One of the most enjoyable things I ever get to do is to have a week off and spend it riding a motorcycle. I cannot put into words how enjoyable that is to me. One of the most enjoyable weeks I've ever spent in my life, Jill was in Florida. Now don't laugh and say, well, okay. But it was October. She went to Florida when school was out. She was still teaching to see our kids. And for some reason I stayed home. And I decided I was going to ride to the Outer Banks on a motorcycle and spend a week just up and down the coast. I never made it. I ended up staying at home every night, but I went a couple hundred, 300 miles every day, seeing the leaves I ended up not knowing where I'd go. I'd go to bed at midnight, get up at 6, and get on it and go. And I loved every minute of it. I cannot put into words how enjoyable it was to me. And I live with this desire to just head across country in a motorcycle. I don't know if I'll ever get to do that in my life for 2, 3, 4 weeks, but just to go do it. And you know the only shadow that hangs over that all the time is this week's going to end. This day's going to end. I don't care if it rains. I don't care if it's frosty in the morning. I've got clothes for that. I don't care. But the negative side of it is, this is going to end. And you listen what that scripture says. You listen. No matter how good things are, they quickly pass and we fly away. If we only knew the power of your anger. And you know why those weeks end? You know why there's a watch on your wrist today? Maybe the fanciest watch you've ever owned. You know why you've got digital set by satellite time in your car? Because we sinned. And we ruptured eternity. And we all die. And so, the psalmist here, the psalm of David, or the psalm of Moses is saying, in verse 12, teach us to number our days. Why? Why does it say to number our days? That we can gain wisdom. Don't spend your time wallowing in your sin or anybody else's. Don't spend your time thinking, I've been cheated. I got hurt. This person didn't like. Don't give a sin of anybody else or your own any more time than it got. And realize that once you were forgiven, you were forgiven. It's over. And as a Christian, your time in life is not numbered. It's eternal. Okay? So those stages, overwhelming confidence, I don't need God. I'm going to fix everybody in the church. I'll do it. God, if you need me for anything, or if you write a book, want me to write a preface to it, get in touch with me, and I'll try to work it out. But I'll take care of this group. I'll take care of this family. I'll take care of my neighbor. And then the next stage is, it didn't work out the way I thought. I'm bitter. I'm angry. Well, what happened with Moses? First 40 years of his life is overconfident. Second 40 years, he's wrapped up in his failures. And the third 40, God said, okay, Moses, you're ready. You're malleable now. And what made Moses different from a lot of people? He still worshiped. He still worshiped. And all of a sudden, once you're broken, and praise God when you are, once you're broken, and let me stop. We've got 100, and I didn't tell you all this. It's how preachers work in numbers, right? We've got 120 young people sitting in Gatlinburg right now. And I wish they could all hear this, but those of you just a little bit over that age, you're in your 20s, you're in your 30s, you hear this. God wants to use you, but he can't till you say, God, and we bow before him, God, come use me. Come use me. And Moses had an experience we know as the burning bush, where he finally said, God, you can use me. Now, he was still caught up in all of that pain. He was still caught up knowing that they wanted him back. And he started saying, I don't know if I can do it, God. I don't know if I can do it. And God basically said, you can do it. You can do it. And listen to the last part of this psalm, starting with verse 13. And you notice how he confronted his overconfidence. He confronted being stuck in our misery. And then he confronted where we should be. He says, relent, Lord. How long will it be? Have compassion on your servant. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love. That's just, and get out of bed in the morning. Let me know of your love. That we may sing for joy and be glad all our days. Make us glad. All of a sudden it's glad, 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 right? Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, for as many years as we have seen trouble. That's our sins. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to their children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Your splendor to be seen. Where do you see the splendor? There's two people that have watched this snow we've had the last couple of days. You'll be able to name them. You'll know somebody. There's those people that say, I hate it when it snows. It's miserable. They've talked on the weather, I'm not going to interact with this horrible snow. What do other people do? Let's go. Let's get out. Let's bust our hind ends and laugh about doing it. Yes, I said hind end in a sermon. You know, how do you look at life? You tell me which one's worshiping. The one that's cursing everything God's ever done. I've heard them on the news the last few days talk about poor old California getting all this snow and all this rain. It's horrible. Wasn't it just about a month ago they said poor old California not getting any rain? You know? But when God is using you, everything you do every day becomes an act of worship. An act of worship. And you know, if I can just please allow me to use that going four-wheeling again. Yes, we took the camera and we were out in the middle of nowhere. And we were standing there and I took a picture of Tammy and John. I took a picture of Mike and Karen. And I gave them a camera and they got a picture of me and Jill standing there in the middle of the woods in the snow. And I was looking at those pictures last night and they're really good. And you think, wow, look at the snow. But you also look at it and say, wow, how blessed I am to have those friends. You know? And we're all sitting here in the midst of that. We're all sitting here in the midst of people who love God and love us. And Eric said a mouthful and said this morning, joined by our brokenness. But I'm going to tell you, joined by God. Because listen to what he says. Make us glad for as many days you afflicted us, for as many years you've seen trouble. Just saying, it's our way now. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to their children. May the favor of the Lord God rest on us and establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. What is that saying? You give us a purpose. We have a reason to even take the next breath. And it's not one that will end. It's not one that will pass. But it's the reason of God's goodness. And that's what you're going to see in Moses. Over the next 8 or 9 weeks, that's what you're going to see in Moses. And the man just like every person here, every man and woman in this room, that went through the confidence, the failures, and finally saw, this is where God will use me. And he became one of the greatest men of all of history. In the middle of those problems. Because this psalm, I will know your work to be my work. Look for how God calls you in the next few weeks. Let's pray. God, thank you that we could worship today in the midst of the cold and small groups, Father. It's been fun. It's just been fun to be here. And for all who are here, Father, I want to say thank you. Just pray thank you for what they mean to me personally, what they mean to each other, Father. We are your children, and we are one family of brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, be with the church at Boone's Creek. May we as a group look for your work. May we meet the needs that you place before us. May we do it with gladness and understanding that in your work they are not days that will pass. Father, thank you that we could worship today. I say that again, and we pray it in Christ's name. Amen. We're going to stand. Small group here today, but if there be any decision anybody wants to make to identify with the church, an elder to pray with you, to be buried with Christ in baptism, I'll ask you to come as we sing.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. journey back across the fold. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Jesus, we thank you for God, our suffering, for our brokenness, and what you are doing in us and through us, and drawing us closer to you to glorify you in everything. God, we praise you for this time together. We may boldly share your message of hope, that there's hope in suffering, that God, that what was intended to harm, you intend for good, to accomplish what you are doing. We thank you, God, that right now that call is for us, and that your love, God, has been shown to us through Jesus. We pray that you help us to see that and to trust you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray this together as your church and as your children. Amen. Have a good rest of your week. You are dismissed. Thank you.